Good morning, everyone. It's really good to be here at COP in the Blue Zone, and we're very excited to have a panel today on local government. All of us are from the Local Government Association, and we're here to run through the importance of the partnership of local government in climate change, reducing our carbon, and trying to make a real difference to our communities. So we're going to start the session with a short 2-minute video clip. Now the technology may beat me, but let's have it.
Our rivers. Our roads. Our green spaces. Our homes. Our future. Climate change is affecting all aspects of our lives and the world we live in. Councils, in their role as local place shapers, have a unique and vital role to play. Only councils can turn national ambitions into joint action on the ground, in the places people live and where businesses thrive. Councils have powers or influence over a third of all greenhouse gas emissions in their area. To date, more than 300 local authorities have declared a climate emergency. Whether it's a zero emission zone in Oxford, or a flood alleviation scheme in Leeds, a community-led biodiversity project in Kingston, or a solar farm in Swindon. Councils are taking action to adapt and mitigate the effects of climate change. Councils want to work as partners with the government, businesses and communities to tackle and adapt to climate change and deliver the UK's net zero target by 2050 or sooner. Local councils are ready to play their part with you.
Thank you very much. So that is our starter for 10, and that is our ask of government, that we are the partner in the way forward in trying to influence our communities, influence our business sector, and trying to make decisions that will make a difference to our place. I'm Izzy Seckham. I am the LGA Vice Chairman, and I am also the leader of Warwickshire County Council. And we in Warwickshire have also done our part in trying to address the issues that we believe are really important to our communities and our growing communities, the communities of the future. Understanding what business can do, trying to help business make those decisions that will mitigate the worst of the impact of carbon. Trying also to look at our own services in development, in how we help with planning, in education and schools, in waste, and other areas. Thank you. And what would be really helpful too would be for you to ask the question about how much impact do you think local government can make on reducing carbon in their place? An interesting question which you may well not yet have the answer to, but can I suggest that it is one third? So it's a significant amount, a really significant amount. Now, if we do this, we have to be a partner to central government in trying to make those changes happen in place. My own council, we have looked at a number of exciting opportunities. We've created a £1 million grant fund available to communities and to parishes to bid into, to try to come up with innovative new ideas on how they too can make a difference in their area, reducing carbon. creating better ways of waste collection, of trying to look at energy. So there's some really exciting opportunities. And what I would say is not one person has the answer to everything. How do we capture that innovation and that opportunity that we know is there in our communities and build on that? So we've got a panel here with us today, and I'm going to ask them each to come forward and say a few words about what they think, what they know, and how they're making a difference as well. And then I'm hoping very much that we will be able to have time for a question and answer session. So can I first introduce Marion Overton? Marion, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thank you very much indeed, Izzy, and good morning, everybody. What a great pleasure it is to be here. So I'm Marion Overton. I'm Vice Chairman of the Local Government and Association, and also a very keen supporter of all of our green issues, making sure that our environment is as it should be. I also represent Lincolnshire County Council and North Caithness District Council, so I'm twin-hatted. It was 30 years ago that I climbed under the ice, crawled under the ice, and put little squirrel recorders in the ice to measure the rate of flow. That time we could see in the Arctic where we were, the huge glaciers of ice were melting and pouring over the edge of the cliffs. This week I heard the sixth assessment of where we are, how we are tackling climate change. And my heart was heavy. We have worked so hard and yet not achieved what we need to achieve. We are not where we need to be. We still have a 2.7 degree rise in global temperatures expected when we're trying to stay under 1.5. And the current projections, if all the promises came through, if all they were backed with money, and they were all backed with the real action, the determined action that's needed, then we would get to 2.4. You might think that's not very important, but what we are seeing with our own eyes, let alone the science, is the impact, the huge catastrophes that we see in all parts of the world. And if we thought that the asylum seekers or the migration that we get now was an issue, what about when it's the whole of Bangladesh or the whole of those low-lying whole countries that are no longer livable because of the extreme weather events that they are suffering? It's not good enough. And that's why all of our councils are really gearing up to do a solid job to really tackle climate change. We must stop our emissions. We must make sure that we build the nature of our environments, restore our environments so that nature can take control and put things back in balance as best as possible. What our councils are working on is a huge number of different initiatives, many of which you saw today. Huge amount of work, huge amount of commitment and support needed from our communities to allow us to do that. It's public money. We need the public to work with us, and we do. As has been mentioned, we also work with the business community. They also have a key. This needs more than one person and more than one organization. It needs all of us to work on it. I think you may have seen our Boris Johnson, our Prime Minister, talking about being 5 minutes before midnight and the ticking bomb and wondering which wire to cut first. But actually, we need to do all of them. So I think it's not actually good enough for us to just say no to coal. We actually have to say no to fossil fuels and wean ourselves off. that's a big step. But it's one where councils will need to demonstrate that we are also taking huge steps forwards. We cannot keep some of the things that have been already put forward. Can we really build 300,000 new houses every single year and keep under net zero? We have, as councils, we have to work really hard at making sure that everything we do is built to the best net zero standards we can create and that we make sure things are in balance. I think just to say finally, I also went to Madagascar a while ago and I met the person who had taken David Attenborough there, and he said that he put his head on the guide's shoulder and wept at the destruction that he saw. This is one of our most pristine, special environments, and this is what we've allowed to happen. We really have to pull our socks up, all of us, and I think we need to make real, dedicated, determined change for the better. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. I'm Pippa Halings, and as other members, I'm a member of the LGA, the Local Government Association, which is councillors across England and Wales. And we have a cross-party national climate change task group looking at this. And this is a really, really important initiative, I think. And I'm a member of that. I'm also a member, together with our leader here, of the South Cambridgeshire District Council. And I want to bring us now to local councils and local councils, for example, in England. So and Wales. What the LGA has done is looked across all of the councils. Over 90% of councils in England and Wales have declared a climate emergency. Less than 20% have declared an ecological or biodiversity emergency. Here at COP26, it's the first time that within the UNFCCC negotiations, there is an explicit recognition of the inextricable links between climate and nature. Yet at our council level, we still need to do more to make sure that we're bringing nature into our planning. At South Cam's District Council, we have a zero carbon strategy, and we followed that with the declaration of an ecological emergency with a doubling nature strategy. They're now sister documents. And it's not easy, but what we're trying to do is say, how do these two documents come together in one action plan that brings together nature-based solutions and our carbon reductions and the adaptation to those climate shocks we can't avoid? Now, that's hard when we look at what do councils do. So there are three ways that councils can really take part in the third of the emissions that Izzy talked about. The UK cannot meet net zero without local councils because we generate, manage, are responsible for a third of the UK's carbon emissions. So UK central government can't do it alone and we can't do it alone. So we need to be able to work together. Councils directly account for between 1 and 5% of the emissions in their area, directly, in terms of their own buildings and their own operations and estate. The bigger amount of those emissions, we indirectly, but hugely influence, and that's through our policies, our standards, our tax, our licensing. We are procurement experts. We shape places with our policy. We are delivery agents with partners on the ground for the massive growth that's happening in many, many areas. And for the adaptation, we were on the front line with COVID with our communities, and we will be on the front line when those climate impacts hit with flooding, with the storms, and with the urban heat stress that the report that came out yesterday said will be hitting, as in other countries, it will now be hitting the UK. The independent climate risk assessment that came out in June said that in 2020, the heat wave in the UK caused 2,500 additional excess deaths attributable to the heat wave. When I worked internationally and with India, the hundreds and hundreds of deaths through the heat waves there were because they were already suffering from the shock of the heat. Their bodies were starting to internally combust. When they got to the hospitals were hotter. And that's what finished them off. It's somebody turned up the temperature and they died on arrival at hospital because of the temperatures in the hospital. The independent climate risk assessment has said that in the UK, 90% of buildings, NHS buildings, are at risk of overheating. And that we are woefully unprepared in the UK for the climate shocks we can't avoid. Local councils will be on the front line. So here in COP, that's why we are all arguing as the LGA, together with the global local government and municipal authority constituency, to work out why, up until now, the Glasgow draft does not mention local government. The Paris preamble mentioned local government and working across all levels. That was for collaboration. Now it's about delivery. And we hope that all of you with us will continue to fight. We've seen the latest draft. That now includes local government and multi-level collaboration and action for delivery of net zero. And we're going to hope that that will continue. Thank you, Izzy. And just like to say that we are here and we have a letter from all of our councils to our Prime Minister Boris Johnson, who I understand will arrive today. It's been signed by the councils that we're, as Lib Dems, in control of or working in, over 353 signatures, and we hope that I will be accepted today. Thank you.
So thank you very much to my panel who are here today. And I wanted to just round that up by saying that as local government councillors and local government in England and Wales, we are place shapers. We have an opportunity to build the place for the future generation that we think should be there. And it's undoubtedly true that what we offer now is not good enough, is not the sort of place that our next generation are looking for us to try to help them to live in. And we have to make a difference. So as we now move forward and ask government to ensure that we are that key partner in developing their policies, in trying to deliver those policies, but also in communicating what our residents are saying to our government to make sure that they are fully aware. We are that conduit and we are such an important part of ensuring that the place that we want for the future is something we can be proud to give to our children and our next generation. It is just a moment in time. So I'm now going to open up to questions. So we have an audience here. And I've already got some hands up. Now, there's a microphone to the side. So can I ask you, there's one that side, there is one that side. So first, if you would like to go there. And also, if there are any questions from those who are watching us on the video link, please do ask the questions and we will make sure that they come forward. So I'm going, first of all, to the left here, my right.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bridget Smith, leader of South Cambridge District Council. I'm reasonably confident that new housing is going to be built to much higher energy efficiency standards. However, by 2050, 95% of our housing stock will be housing stock that's here now. How can local government work with central government in order to ensure the retrofitting of the existing housing stock, and how is it going to be paid for?
Thank you, Bridget. That's an excellent question and really important. As we move into planning and having the white paper that comes forward, I think we are all hoping very much that some of the influence that we're seeking will be about how future housing will be built to a standard that we would hope that will start making those changes. One, that they are warm houses. They're affordable houses to live in because their energy is low cost. And equally, the point that you bring up, which is retrofitting the stock that we have, is such a key question. And the influence that we have in trying to get government to bring some funding forward, perhaps using the infrastructure bank to make that a key priority, I think is the way forward. But let me ask my colleagues. Shall I do that? Yes. So firstly, can I take some questions from this side? Have we got three people who want to ask questions?
How are you specifically addressing environmental justice concerns with policy, and are you centering marginalized voices within these policies?
I wonder if I could ask you to just take your mask off, because it's a bit of a thank you.
How are you specifically addressing environmental justice concerns with policy, and are you centering marginalized voices within these policies?
Thank you. Do you want to answer that question now, and then we'll...
And then pass that one to Pippa.
Are we doing in order? Which ones are we doing?
I think you're probably well to answer.
Thank you very, very much. So that, I'm so glad that you've asked that of us, because that's a key question that's often asked really in developing countries as well, where they've got the highest biodiversity and, you know, about that environmental justice. But it's as important for us in the UK. So what I can say is, one is to declare a biodiversity or ecological emergency, to recognise, first of all, that there is an issue and that local councils do have something to do about that. Then to have a biodiversity, or what we've called a doubling nature strategy. And in planning terms, so we're just about to develop our new local plan. And what we've done for the first time is to reach out way beyond the normal people that will answer local plan consultations. So that has been to go to bus stops, to in front of supermarkets, to youth centres, into the urban centres where there are, and make it that it doesn't have to be only online responses to the consultation, but it can be community group meetings where somebody notes down and people then sign. So what we're doing is, in a quite a clunky and often quite, there's some very loud voices in local plan or built planning applications, but it's not necessarily the vulnerable people or those that are speaking out for biodiversity and for nature or who will be impacted. For example, what we found in the pandemic was about access to nature and how important access to nature is for mental and physical health. A study came out to show that a quarter of children who are in urban areas had zero or less than one access to some kind of green area in a month. So in the UK, 25% of children had zero or less than one visit a month to some kind of green space. That's the level of, I think you're talking about, environmental justice. One is, do we make sure that that environment is enhanced and maintained, and two, who has access to it. So what we're looking for is, within the planning policy, do we bring in, and this is one of the proposals, it was being put forward here at COP, 330-300. So, which is that, you know, you should be able to see three trees from your window. And you should be able to have access to an area within 300 metres of where you live. Is there some kind of park area, urban park area, or green space area? So this 330-300, the European WHO and the European Commission have looked at those as standards. We'd like to look at those in our planning.
I'm going to ask if... we can have the next two questions. Could we be reasonably quick? We've got 5 minutes of this session, so I will go to my colleagues then. Thank you.
So you said that you want to build the future generation that you think should be there. I was wondering, are you planning to include the future generation in these discussions? And like following off of that same question, like historically unheard voices, how are we planning to do that?
Thank you. Shall we take the... last question.
Hello, I'm an Antarctic ice sheet modeller. I was wondering how much power local authorities have to protect our coastline against sea level rise.
Could you just say protect?
Our coastline against sea level rise.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Picking up the issues about the coastline first, because I represent, come from Lincolnshire, where we have a lot of wonderful coastline. It is low-lying. We have calculations demonstrate that a large part of our county will be underwater before very long, and the maps are all quite clear. That is our farming area. That's where your food, the majority of, if you live in UK, we call ourselves the breadbasket of the UK. We provide a large part of vegetables and food for the country. So that is likely to be underwater in the current state. So certainly huge protections. The other issue with that is that we cannot afford, or with help from the governments, we still can't seem to afford to actually protect that area. You can't keep the sea back. We've been allowing it to come in and take over the farmland and become wetlands for wildlife instead. So it is a serious issue for us in the future, and thank you for raising it. The last one was about regeneration. I'm not exactly sure I heard it very clearly. Just to say,
It was about the younger generation's voice, actually, and how are we going to capture that?
Oh, thank you. That's great. Actually, the younger generation is absolutely crucial, because this is your lives, this is your future, and I think that's why it is so powerful when we hear younger people talking about their own lives. This is not something in the future. This is actually their lives that we're talking about destroying. So I think it's really, really important that we hear those voices. And thank you that they've been so powerful during this COP26.
And I'd very much like to introduce our colleague, Nick Forbes, who's just managed to get here and very late. The last word will be with you, Nick. And it's about how do we build this into the important things, the place shaping of the future.
Thanks, Izzy, and hello, everybody. I've been a victim of queuing this morning. I think just to reflect more broadly on the role of local government and place-based approaches to tackling climate change, there can sometimes be a mindset that it's somebody else's responsibility, it's a government responsibility, somebody else is going to fix the problem. And what we're doing, and I think this is apparent from the work that we're doing within the LGA, is both demonstrating the importance of mobilising a consensus for change amongst our communities, and you can only really do that at a local level because it's about the place that they feel connected to, and we can also build coalitions for change amongst our key partners, our anchor institutions, our major organisations at a local level. There is no such thing as a national economy. We have lots of local economies, and many of us are working to understand and seize the opportunities that net zero and climate change presents in terms of the next generation of goods and products and services that we need to invent. Local government, I think, is really at the forefront of this, certainly in the UK. And in parallel with the G7 summit that was held a couple of months ago, I created and chaired the what we call the U7 summit, which was the networks of the major cities in the G7 countries. And the two things that everybody in those networks said without any qualification was, firstly, all of our national and federal government's targets are too late. We need to be moving quicker and faster. And secondly, we can't do this without local government leading local places and leading our communities to a better future. And anybody who thinks that it can be done without us is frankly not going to catch the boat on climate change. So we're such an important part of the agenda, and it's really great to be able to talk about the work that we're doing in local government here over the next couple of days.
Thank you very much, Nick. It's great to have you with us. And I have to say, it is lovely to be here in person and see people and have these really important conversations. And I wanted to just touch on the question about the next generation and how we should ensure that we build the voice of young people into those decisions that we're making, because they are for that next generation. So each local council, I think, would be advised, if they are not already, and you know, the ones that I know are doing this, but talk with your young people, talk with your youth parliaments. These are actually us, this panel of the future. They will have those ideas and they will generate the thoughts in their peer groups that we think are so important for the future. So I think what you've got here is a panel that is united across the political divides that we have, united in our ability to try to drive an agenda that is going to be something that we will be proud of, a future that we can guarantee for our children, and something that we want to ensure will be exciting, because there will be businesses that are coming around out of this. I look upon it as a new industrial revolution, and all of us would want those businesses in our own areas and be proud of that. I look forward to being part of that and co-producing that with my colleagues, but also with my next generation. And I thank you for listening to us today, and I hope government will be listening to us and ensuring we are the key delivery partner for the future. Thank you all.